this important common condition, the ECG, basics of ECG. So there are so many advancements in field of cardiology.
Yeah,
there is so many like 3D mapping and echocardiography, advancement in echocardiography. But still the ECG holds the key. Still ECG has a role, and we must know, even if your specialty is not cardiology, if you are nephrology or some other specialty, you must have some basic knowledge of ECG so that the conditions should be diagnosed early. So first time in 1842, the Carlo realized that electricity is associated with heartbeat. In 1895, William Beethoven credited for invention of EKG, and 1906, this was first invented, first used clinically. So this was the first ECG machine. You have to put your hand in jar, in saline jar for ECG. So this was the first so large machine for ECG. So ECG is representation of electrical event of cardiac cycle. Each event has a distinct waveform. The study of waveform can lead to greater insight into the patient cardiac pathophysiology. So why we should use ECG? ECG is still with help of ECG we can diagnose the arrhythmia. Even heart block cannot be diagnosed with all advancement in cardiology. ECG is still required. ECG is still the indication for pacemaker is still on the basis of ECG. And there are so many arrhythmias can be diagnosed solely on basis of ECG. It is very helpful in diagnosis of myocardial infarction or ischemia. Pericarditis can be diagnosed with help of ECG. And chamber hypertrophy because of pressure overload or volume overload situation. And it is also very helpful in diagnosis of electrolyte imbalance. And drug toxicity we can have a view with the ECG. So here you can see the pulse, the wave is generated from the SA node, that is the pacemaker center of the heart. Then it goes into the AV node, then it goes into the percutaneous fiber, and that decolonizes the heart. First the wave generated in RA, then it goes into the LA, and through RA it goes into the AV node, then bundle of it, then percutaneous fiber. So this is a sequence of depolarization, and after depolarization the contraction of heart takes place. So this is how it is spread. This is how it spread from SA node to AV node. So if there is any blockage in bundle of it, that is called bundle branch block. So this is how depolarization wave takes place. Initially there is depolarization from SA node, it goes into AV node, and then the whole ventricular depolarization takes place. So this is the ECG, usual ECG what we record, the P wave. P wave depends upon the RA and LA depolarization, and the earlier portion of P wave is because of depolarization of RA, then the later portion is because of depolarization of LA. Then there is the Q wave, the initial negative wave is Q wave, then the positive wave is R wave, and this negative wave is S wave. Then there is ventricular repolarization. After ventricular depolarization, there is repolarization of the ventricle, and that causes QT interval. So when there is depolarization of the heart, it produces the several wave, and on the basis of that, we recognize the condition. So this P wave, this segment from end of P wave to Q wave is PR segment, and this is QRS complex, this is ST segment. So important thing is the isoelectric line. This ST segment should have the same line. If there is elevation, we call it ST elevation MI. If there is depression, we call it ST depression, non-ST elevation MI. So the normal PR interval is around 120 up to 200 milliseconds. And the normal PRS duration is around 120 milliseconds, 3 small square. When there is duration is wide, more than 3 small square, then it is called wide PRS ECG. And the normal QT interval is around 440 milliseconds. So there are 3 standard, 12 lead is there, 3 standard limb lead, 3 augmented limb lead, and 6 precordial lead. So this is the chest beat from V1 to V6. The V1 and V2 is look after the anterior portion of the heart. The V2 and V3 is septal, and V5, V6 is called lateral portion of the heart. This first plate is recognize the potential difference between the left and right arm. The second the difference between the right arm and foot, and the third one is from foot to leg. So we can take the ECG from right side also when there is dectrocardia. So in that condition, we have to record the ECG from the right side also, and this is the usual reversal of the normal ECG recording in the right side. And when there is posterior wall MI, if something is happening in posterior wall that is poorly represented in anterior chest, so we can record the ECG in the posterior wall also, in posterior axial line, mid scapular, and just lateral to the spine, like in posterior wall MI. So this V1 and V2 is looking after this portion of the heart, the V3 and V4 the septal, and V5, V6 is the lateral portion of the heart. So the when we see the P wave, the earlier portion is right atrium. If there is enlargement because of the enlargement of the right atrium, that will cause predominant P wave more than 2.5 millivolt. And when there is left atrium enlarged, that will cause negative deflection. So whenever there is enlargement of the right atrium, that will be reflected the earlier portion of the P wave. Whenever there is enlargement of left atrium, that will be reflected in negative portion of the P wave. So there are some portions that, like inferior wall, it is being represented in second, third AVR. The anterior wall, it is represented in V1 and V2. Lateral wall is represented in first and AVR V5. So any change which takes place in ECG in particular segment will denote the damage of that segment. So the septal is V1, V2, the anterior wall is V1, V4, and the lateral wall first AVR V5, V6, anterior wall is second, third AVR. The other important thing is when wave is going towards the lead. So any wave is going towards the lead. Suppose if deflection is going towards the V1, the positive deflection will be there in V1. And if some wave is going away from the V6, that will cause negative deflection in V6. So the same wave will be represented in other leads, positive and negative. So we should start with the rate, rhythm, axis, P wave, and PR interval. The rate we can, this is normal ECG the paper. The smaller one is of 40 milliseconds. The five smaller segment is 200 milliseconds. And normal speed is around 25 milliseconds. If speed is high, the thing will change. The usual speed is 25. If we want to take the P wave clearly, we have to increase the speed. So like in this ECG, we should calculate the larger square, like 1, 2, 3, 4. So larger 300 divided by the larger square is the heart rate. Like here, 300 can be divided with 4. So that is the heart rate. We can calculate the smaller square also. The number of a smaller square, like in one box, there is 5 small square. So 15 small square. So 100 is divided by 1500 is divided by the number of a small square. So we can calculate the rate. So if there is irregular heart rate, in that condition, the 10 second of rhythm per phase, count the number of the beat present in the EKG multiplied by 6. So we can calculate the heart rate even with the irregular heart rate. So we should look for the whether P wave is present or not. If there is present, whether it is regular or irregular, does one precede every QRS complex? So with P wave we can have a good idea about the rhythm. Then we should determine the axis. The axis determines the depolarization pattern of the heart. It will depend upon the muscle mass as well as the electrical conduction. So if anything is positive, that is predominantly positive. If the predominant negative, here the S wave is predominant, so it is predominantly negative. And equiphasic, the R wave and S wave, the length is same, so it is equiphasic. For determination of ECG, this is important. So we should look for the equiphasic waveform. we should look for the equiphasic. This is axial system, and we should look for the equiphasic waveform. Suppose if there is equiphasic in AVR, so we should look for the perpendicular to AVR, and that is the axis of the ECG. So determination of axis important. This axis will change in arrhythmia. Like if basic ECG axis is 90, and during arrhythmia change into the northwest axis, then it help in diagnosis due particularly during arrhythmia, whether it is supraventricular or ventricular tachycardia. And other thing is, if there is axis in left axis, the left axis is between minus 30 to minus 90, and right axis is plus 90 to 180. And this is northwest axis or extreme axis in between this. So we should determine the axis by seeing the ECG, and that is helpful in diagnosis of the condition. And we can decide the axis in more rapid way also. We should look for the first and second. If both are positive, then this is normal axis. If the first is positive and second is negative, then it is left axis. And if the first is negative and second is positive, then it is right axis. So we can assess the axis by seeing the ECG, simply by seeing the first and we should go by the equiphasic the approach. The most equiphasic is QRS template. We should look for that. Identify the lead 90 degrees away from the lead and QRS in the positive lead. Like here, the most equiphasic way we should recognize that. Like this one, the AVF is most equiphasic here. So AVF is this, and the perpendicular to AVF is this. 0 to the first, then we should look for the first is positive, so axis is 0 degree. So first we should look for the equiphasic, then we look for the perpendicular, and whether perpendicular is positive or negative. Suppose if one is negative, then axis will be here. So the QRS duration should be less than 120 milliseconds, and in bundle branch block there is duration is increased. Like normally the QRS duration is less than 120 milliseconds. In RBP, there is widening of the QRS in V1 lead. So in V1 lead, you will see the RSR pattern, and in V6, there will be ST depression, discordant to this pattern. In LBP, there is predominant S wave in V1 and predominant R wave with notch feature with discordant ST depression in LBP. So when there is LBP, there is changes like this.